Welcome, friends and family, to the 47th Annual Mount Desert Island High School Graduation Ceremony. We're here this afternoon to celebrate these young adults before me who have both given and received so much from this wonderful community. It has been my pleasure and privilege to know them and work with them during their time in high school. Before we go any further, I'd like to take a few moments to say thank you to those who have helped the graduates along the way. It would be difficult to overstate how unique the level of support and engagement we have from our community is. It is a gift to partner with experts from renowned organizations, including the College of the Atlantic, Acadia National Park, the Jackson Lab, and the MDI Bio Lab. It's also amazing to witness the continued financial support that our community provides us. Local businesses generously provide our students with needs that arise. Donors provide for hundreds of thousands of dollars in local scholarships. And over 100 community members serve as mentors for senior exhibition projects each year. I speak now to the families of our students, particularly of those who are graduating today. You've raised amazing young men and women, and that did not happen by accident. Thank you for all the love, patience, and time you have given to them. Thank you also for trusting us to guide them through their high school years. MDI High School is blessed with a tremendous faculty and staff who give endlessly of their passion, energy, and wisdom. No school, whatever other traits it may offer, can be successful without top-quality educators coming to work every day. We are all indebted to these dedicated professionals. This year, we are fortunate to be joined by two new faculty members. These individuals have each put their own mark on MDI High School and have made it a better place for students. The new faculty at MDI High School this year are Brooke Garapi and Kendra Mishin. ...2015 will see us bid farewell to seven valued members of our faculty and staff. We wish them well in their future endeavors. Let's say thank you to Marlene Karras, Greg Moore, Janet Snoke, Joel Linske, Diane Bonzi, Whitey Griffin, and Jamie Gonzalez. And finally, without engaged, curious, motivated, and talented students, what would a school be? The students that attend MDI High School are, unquestionably, its greatest asset. The class of 2015 is a unique collection of students who have the distinction of truly appreciating how lucky we are to live in such a beautiful place. Such regard for our surroundings is not common. The class of 2015 are also an extremely talented group in the classroom, on the athletic field, and as visual and performing artists. They will be sorely missed. Let's give them another round of applause. David Anderson is one of those students. He's also one of our senior class officers. He'll be introducing this afternoon's guest speaker. David has participated in the Show Choir Pit Orchestra, sailing, cross country, hearing committee, National Honor Society, and the MDIHS Interact Club. He's also worked as an intern for Friends of Acadia with their Acadia Youth Technology team for two summers. During his junior year, he spent fall semester in Colorado at the High Mountain Institute, a small school that couples academics with backcountry travel and leadership training. He'll be attending Bowdoin College in the fall. David is the son of John and Karen Anderson of Town Hill.
Welcome. It is my pleasure to introduce our graduation speaker for the day. Dr. Darren Collins first came to MDI as an undergraduate student at the College of the Atlantic. Immediately upon reaching the island, Darren showed a passion for the outdoors, the state, and the island. For a senior project, he helped design the college's white water, white paper class, which incorporates weekly canoe trips into studies of water management. Upon his graduation in 1992, he received a Watson Fellowship to study social and environmental impacts of hydroelectric dams in Latin America. Inspired by his time abroad, he proceeded to attend Tulane University, where he received a master's degree in Latin American studies and a PhD in anthropology. From 2001 to 2011, Darren worked for the World Wildlife Fund and managed conservation programs in the Amazon, Mongolia, and the Russian Far East. Now he has returned to the island to serve as president of COA. He's a teacher, a leader, and a friend in the community, and I am so pleased to welcome him as our commencement speaker. Without further ado, Dr. Darren Collins.
Hi, everyone. Does it make you nervous when somebody gets out like a big stack of papers for a talk like this? It's another beautiful day on the most beautiful island in the world. And I won't soon forget that moment a few weeks back when I got that message from David Anderson on my phone asking if I'd be up for this talk. And I was really, to the bone, touched and honored. It meant so much to me personally, but also meant a lot institutionally, because I think it signaled this strong and growing relationship between the College of the Atlantic, the school system, and the island as a whole. It made me very, very happy. But a handful of seconds after that happiness and pride, this wave of panic swept over my body. Right? I give loads of talks, and I generally like to talk in front of people, but let's be honest, commencement speeches generally fail miserably, right? I put that failure rate at something around 95%, maybe. And most fail not because they're wrong or rude, but because they're just forgettable and they're long, right? Despite weeks of thought by the speaker, by the time graduates throw their hats in the air, everyone has forgotten. Now, I have an eighth grader, Maggie Collins, and Maggie will be coming to MDI High next year. And when I told her this, that most speeches fail because they're just not memorable, she said to me, "Dad, please fail. Please do not be memorable. Whatever you do, do not be memorable." Poor Maggie, I feel so bad. But in an effort to find my way into that percentage of good talks, I did some anthropological research and I went to the MDI prom, you know, to get to know people a little bit. And of course, this really mortified Maggie. And to be honest, it was a little creepy, I think. It was a little bit creepy. But at that event, I asked a few administrators, you know, who really hit it out of the park? Who is the best speaker ever? And universally, they said, Eddie Monet, Diver Ed, right? Very proud of Eddie. Right? And of course, they recalled how Eddie came up on stage in a dry suit, and I wasn't there, but I'm guessing he inflated it, and then, like, released this flatulence from the neck, probably something like that. But I'm also willing to bet that Eddie gave a great talk, an insightful talk, because it wasn't patronizing. He wasn't like, you need to go do this or do that. And he didn't try and answer all these problems that you might face. And that's a good thing, because I think the fact is no one really knows. Right? There's not a straight line between where you guys are now and where you ought to be a few years from now. There's not this clean break between success and failure, between greatness and mediocrity. The world is very complex, it's very confusing, and it's only becoming more complex and more confusing every year. 50 years ago, this job that I have now was simple, right? Hey, congratulations, now you go get a job, you have a family, you spend 40 years with a business, and you retire hopefully with some savings. There, take care. But that doesn't exist anymore, right? I'm 45 years old, and I have absolutely no idea what you should expect 20-some years from now when you turn 45. We have no idea the way the world is going to work. I thought about, you know, publicly boycotting this, because really, you know, if you're over 25, you shouldn't be given a commencement address, right? You just shouldn't. But I didn't think that was fair, so instead I'm going to tell three stories, just three, and I hope they're entertaining at least. Story number one occurs between my junior and senior year. I was 16 and I had this wicked mullet and I was very, very proud of it. And I was a part of six students and two counselors working with a program called the Student Conservation Association. It's a program that puts kids to work in very harsh environments for no pay. kind of like child labor camp, right? And it was my first experience with the open West and my first experience with work. Now, I didn't grow up spoiled. I mean, I had a job. I worked at the New Jersey Video Vault, you know, but this was very, very different. We were building 2 miles of barbed wire fence with our hands, with post hole diggers and with come-alongs, no machinery, no equipment. Now, if the counselors were softies, they could have let us kind of dig around in the dirt for a while and then say, yeah, good, there you're done, that's a nice personal experience. But Harold and Gail Lindebo were not soft. They were these hardcore back-to-the-landers, and they worked us to death. They were also very, very smart and two of my earliest mentors. We'd finished our 2 miles of barbed wire, and we went on to this other fence called the jack pole fence, which is like a cross like this, and then other things going that way. I had worked really hard, and at this one day I was kind of standing around, just kind of scratching myself, not knowing what to do. And Harold came up to me and he said, Darren, what's going on? And I said, well, I don't really know what to do. You never told me what to do. And then in this way that left this deep psychic scar, Harold said to me, Darren, I thought we moved past that, right? Not everyone's gonna lay things out for you and explain what to do next. Sometimes you have to look at the situation, assess it, and have a go at it. And that 10 seconds never, ever, ever left my mind. That's story one. Story two is 12 years later, I'm doing a PhD in anthropology with my wife Karen, and we're down in northern Guatemala where I was doing field work among a group of people called the Quechí Maya. They're corn farmers in Guatemala, right? Corn is the lifeblood of these folks. It's ubiquitous in the landscape and in the language. It is everything. It determines who they were, when they worked, where they worked. Corn set the pace and the direction for these people's lives. I know many of you, or some of you at least, went to Guatemala on this trip, and I hope maybe you saw that. But I'd never planted corn before, right? And one day, after being there long enough, the guy said, come on, Darren, we want you to plant corn with us. I said, okay. So I was given this bag full of seed, I was given a big digging stick, and I was given instruction. Now what you have to do, I'm gonna use this, you have to take, you know, you take a step, right? You take a step, take your digging stick, and you plant it in, and you open up a little hole, and you drop 4 seeds, not 3 or not 5, 4 seeds in the hole, you kind of kick it over, and then you move on, right? That was the instruction. Fair enough. So we're on this hillside of all guys, right? Because only guys plant corn, and there are 25 guys up the hillside, 25 down the hillside. And without barely making a motion, the elder man next to me kind of nods his head, and off we go, right? And immediately I drop 3 corn seeds, and none of them go in the hole, and I'm falling over, and I'm trying to push some dirt on, and nothing's going right, and it's a ridiculous mess. And 3 or 4 or 5 steps go on, the same thing, just a complete, complete failure. And I stand up, and there are 50 guys across the end of the field with their arms crossed looking at me. Me, in the middle of this field, like complete, complete embarrassment, complete laughter. And for the most part, after some time and some mentoring, I got the idea and I made it across. But the point isn't about whether I learned the task or not. The point is in the power of experience. Especially experience where you throw yourself into something very, very difficult, very, very challenging. An experience that kind of rips you out of your body and puts you back into the body of a child. That is enormous. It will have an enormous impact on you. And it will thicken your skin. And wow, today, I think when I look at humanity, kids, 18-year-olds, 20-year-olds, we need thicker skin. We really, really do. Last story, 1984, summer before my freshman year, my cousin, who for me was the closest thing I had to a sibling, he took me aside one day, and I'll never forget this. He said explicitly, listen, I went to private school, and so I didn't have to deal with this. But you, Darren, you are going to public school, and if you want to be the first one in your family to go to college, whatever you do, don't sign up for any of those silly shop classes. They're a waste of time and they're for losers. Now this makes my poor cousin sound like a complete jerk, and he's not. He was really a good guy. He didn't know any better. But I listened to him with that same intensity as I listened to Harold and Gail Lindebo back in Idaho. And from that point forward, there was this strange division between working with your hands and working with your mind. And working with your hands was bad, something to be avoided, and working with your mind was good and success. Fast forward 25 years, when I decide to purchase this unbelievably beautiful truck that I've named Scarlett. Scarlett is a 1985 Toyota Land Cruiser FJ60, and she's parked outside, and if anyone wants to come and take your picture afterwards with Scarlett, I would love that. But by then, this division between mind and body had eroded, at least intellectually. But a month after I got the car, I was driving the truck up in North Georgia when this enormous buck came along and T-boned me. Right in the side, almost impaled it. There were windows flying, there were doors crumpling in. Everything on the right side of my vehicle was smashed. And at that moment, I decided to move from an intellectual understanding of hands work to a very practical one. And I embarked on the Let's Fix Scarlett and Make Her Last Forever project. And through Scarlett, I learned this harsh discipline of a hacksaw, the patience of drying paint, and I now live by the tenet that if your hands aren't dirty with the filth of practice, I think you're wrong. Scarlett is this constant reminder that the complexity of the world requires the artist, the humanist, and the scientist in one being, and that knowledge comes from the use of brain and body or hands together. And because these things also define human ecology, which is what we study at the College of the Atlantic, Scarlett is an odd but constant reminder of why I'm here at COA and on MDI. So that's the third story. And at this point, I could say, graduates, the moral of the story is, A, work hard and don't always wait to be told what to do. That's Idaho. Have experiences that are uncomfortable and push you to failure and force you to laugh on yourself. That's about yourself. That's Guatemala. And work with your minds and your hands. That's Scarlett the truck. And I do believe these things very, very strongly. And I think no matter what your long-term goals are, you should have been required to take shop class with Mr. Munger and Mr. Deans. I think we have two of the most dedicated, smart, thoughtful instructors in them, and two of the coolest shops in the state. Thank you, Mr. Deans. Yeah. But that's not my conclusion. Whether you remember those stories or remember my beliefs, I don't think it really matters. What matters, I think, is that at this point in your life, you should be very, very aware and thoughtful of how you come to believe things. I think that if you do that, you'll come and you'll see that you'll develop beliefs through mentors, you'll develop beliefs through intense and intimate experience with the world around you. And I think you'll also recognize that beliefs will change over time, and that's okay. Beliefs are what makes us human. We are essentially a big body full of beliefs. And the most complete human being is one that surrounds him or herself with as many and as many diverse mentors as possible. The most complete being is one that learns continuously, develops this thick skin, and comes to love life through experience. And the most complete human being is one who is aware and values how we're all shaped by the world around us. And your experience here on Mount Desert Island, whether you know it or not, baked things into you and into your being that you will never, never forget and that will be part of you forever. We are so incredibly privileged to be part of this remarkable place. So congratulations, seniors. Congratulations, friends and family. Congratulations to teachers. And don't forget to turn the lights off when you leave MDI. Thank you.
with a tough act to follow, I'd like to introduce our student speakers. The first speaker is Helena Munson. Helena has been chosen as a featured speaker in today's ceremony. Academically, she is an avid lover of life science and the natural world and has pursued that interest over the past 4 years. Helena recently completed an internship at the Jackson Laboratory. She's also been involved in volleyball, swimming, the spring play, sailing, and National Honor Society throughout high school. Helena will be attending the University of Massachusetts in the fall with the hopes of pursuing pre-medicine with a major in life science. Helena is the daughter of Amy and Brent Walls of Mount Desert.
Well, I don't have any cool stories about corn, but here goes nothing.
Okay.
Hi, everyone. I thought that I would start off my speech by saying thank you. This is the first graduation speech I've ever written, big surprise, so I don't know how else to start. I'd like to start by thanking you all, the audience and community that have joined us here today. Even through the mild irritation of the rising temperature and lack of personal space, you have all persevered and gathered to celebrate an immense occasion and an incredible group of individuals. Which leads me to my next part, my classmates. I'd like to thank all of you, my peers, for not only giving me the best 4 years I could have asked for, but for also entrusting me to speak at your graduation and not botch it up, fingers crossed, but also to be a voice for you all and hopefully resonate a little of how you have all felt throughout our time here and what the future holds. The final thank you I would like to begin with is to the teachers and faculty. Without them, I can honestly say that I, at least, would not be here. And may I be so bold as to say that we have some of the most awesome teachers, guidance counselors, faculty, and administrators, Jabron, ever. I can't even begin to describe how fortunate we are. I feel like I have infinite resources surrounding me and infinite support. How many schools do you think there are where you can joke, hug, laugh, cry, and celebrate with the teachers like we can here? I have had so many good memories and connections that I can't imagine leaving them. I mean, we get invited to their future wedding, Shanny, and they ask and answer our very serious existential questions, such as DeCordy, for example, asking, why is milk the fastest drink? Because it's pasteurized before you know it. Get it? Give me some nods on that. And on top of that, we have both ridiculously awesome bear hugs. Those are just a few examples, when I know there are probably hundreds more. They have truly helped us to grow and mature into the individuals that are seated here today. Okay. On the note of maturity, I would like to perhaps reflect upon the growth that has definitely transpired throughout these long 4 years. I remember quite fondly freshman year, as I'm sure you all do. I was younger, energetic, and I thought I was really cool because I was in high school. Looking back, I'm sure all of us remember with great fondness the time we had in Global Lit. Moving on, sophomore and junior year definitely felt the most real to me out of my 4 years here. I felt the most like a member of this high school, and they are the years where I met the most people, made the most friends, and honestly took the most classes. I mean, who can forget sophomore year wearing the absolutely most flattering color for Spirit Week? And the surprise day off we had at the end of the year. I bet you thought I wouldn't bring that up. And then junior year, loving life as we stressed about standardized testing. Senior year has been a blast. I'll never forget the comeback of the century in tug of war, or slaughtering the alma mater at the pep rally, and showing the underclassmen who's boss. But so much of my mind this year has been elsewhere, looking ahead at my future, which really shows a huge transition. Overall, I think we have all come a long way, to say the least. All of us have gradually gotten calmer, settled down, and hopefully gotten more rational as the years have progressed, which I think is a true sign of maturity. We have all grown up and are at the point where we begin to know who we are and what we want out of life. As of now, I am so proud to call myself a member of the class of 2015. Looking out, I see so many incredible individuals. As a class, we are some of the most diverse, unique, and inspiring people. All of us have our unique strengths and traits that make us up. Some of us are incredible athletes. Some of us are extraordinary musicians or artists. Some of us can, like, build a car from scratch, which I think is really impressive. Some of us just really love the color orange. And some of us are going to Harvard, so you know it's a wide variety. However, all of us bring something to the table, and I know that individually and collectively, we will make an incredible impact on the world. I'm not done. Looking ahead, although this time may be bittersweet, there is so much to look forward to. As blossoming adults, we get to look forward to college, work, we get to be independent, we get to call Mr. Braun Ian, and we get to be active members of the world around us. Although the future may seem scary, let's be honest, all of us have some fear of the unknown. We could not have been better prepared than we have been here. It might have been nice to learn how to file taxes, buy a house, or change a car tire, but hey, we'll get there eventually. Our community has been unbelievably supportive throughout our endeavors, and the guidance we have received from this place will take us very far. Also, even if leaving this place seems scary, I know that the friends I have made here are lifelong ones, and they will love and support me going into the future. So what can I say? I love y'all. So as we graduate from this place and look to the future, let's celebrate. This monumental transition from childhood to adulthood should be exciting. All of us here have unyielding potential, and now is the time to tap into that and make the future the best it can be. But always remember where you came from and appreciate the people that have gotten you here. This is probably just as bittersweet for them. I thought I would try to end this speech with a little bit of inspiration. And here is what I came up with, a quote. And just so you guys know, I found this by Googling inspirational quotes for a high school graduation. So, to quote our former president, George W. Bush, to those of you who received honors, awards, and distinctions, I say well done. And to the C students, I say you too can be president of the United States. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. Our next speaker is Will Green. Will is a senior class officer, and he has also been chosen to represent his class as a speaker today. He's played soccer all 4 years and is a three-time state champion diver. Academically, he is primarily interested in math and science and is a 2015 National Merit Scholarship winner. He's a member of the Student Council and National Honor Society. Outside of school, he's a member of the MDI-YMCA Board of Directors and spends time volunteering for Friends of Acadia. He loves the outdoors and spends most of his time biking, hiking, paddling, photographing, and exploring in Acadia National Park. In the fall, he will be attending Middlebury College in Vermont to study environmental science and biology. Will is a son of Bo Green and the late Craig Green of Bar Harbor.
Oh boy. Congratulations, everyone. It's been a great 4 years hanging out and getting to know you all. I'm very honored to have been asked to talk to all of you today, so I will do my best to be inspirational. I wish every one of my classmates the very best as we leave high school and go out on our next adventures, whatever they may be. I'm sure it will be hard for all of us on some level, to leave this place, whether we're literally leaving the island or just leaving the safety and comfort of the MDIHS community. We've grown up on or next to, arguably, the most gorgeous, diverse, and functional island in the country, in an amazingly supportive and vibrant community, and in a school that cares deeply about each and every one of us. I certainly wouldn't have wanted to grow up anywhere else. Leaving MDI is going to be really hard for me. I hope it will be my home again in the future. But I know for me and for all of us, it's time to go exploring, to find new and exciting opportunities to better ourselves and the world around us. I think perhaps the coolest and scariest part of us leaving is our excellent timing. We're entering the world at a pretty unique point in history. I mean, let's face it, shit's getting real out there. We've got all sorts of really significant issues reaching the breaking point at this very moment. The climate is changing and getting to the point of no return. California is bone dry while Texas is inundated. Many of the 7 billion residents of the planet lack the resources to live healthy, sustainable lives, and many of the world's governments are unstable. Nepal is in tatters. The wealth gap in our country and the world is bad enough, and it's only getting worse. Incidents of public servants abusing their power are in the news each and every day, while many people feel marginalized. With all this going on, it's clear that the world needs some serious help. For most of my life, I've had this idea that I wanted to go out and fix the world. I imagined finding the perfect job that would allow me to find the right answers and figure out how to implement them. I've now realized that our problems are way too big for me to fix by myself. Yes, I do have the potential to make an impact on the world, but I can only do so much as a kid from Maine. We need so much change, and help isn't going to come from one person or one group of people. The only solution to any of these problems, hunger, cancer, climate change, or whatever, is through a communal effort from a whole lot of people. And not just a whole lot of like-minded people, but people of every kind. The truth is that it takes all kinds to make this world a better place for us, our children, and everybody else out there. The world needs people of all races, religions, political parties, and areas. Why? Because no one person or group, no matter how enlightened they may seem to be, can think from all sides of a problem or issue. I can preach all day about the things that I believe in, but my passion comes from my background and my interests. Do I know how to look at all sides of any of the issues I've talked about? Heck no, it takes a village. Our beloved state needs protecting, but it also needs jobs. We can't stop fishing, for an example, as an easy solution to protecting the ocean. It's way more complicated than I can deal with. I can make inspirational videos about Acadia and its stunning ocean, but I don't even know how to drive a boat. There are guys right here who have been fishing for years. We need folks like Brandon and Jordy to not only haul the lobsters, which are the foundation of Maine's economy, but also to participate in tough conversations about finding the balance between harvesting now and protecting for the future. You guys know the oceans and fisheries way better than the rest of us do. While protecting the environment is my kind of thing, there are so many more issues out there that need attention too. We need coders like Ethan and Nick to model things and solve problems through technology. We need Clifton, Jenny, Bailey, and Jake from State Farm to engineer the stuff of the future. We need Hamish to look after our rivers. We need Molly and Cordell to be freaking awesome police officers who use patience as often as their pistols. We need to figure out how to make engines run cleaner and longer. We need to fix them, too. I can't do that, but Allie Goodwin can. We need Topher. Thank you. We need Topher to build more efficient houses for us. We need doctors like Waylon, Helena, and Aiden to save people from things like cancer. And we need Ivy, Kayla, and Hannah to nurse and care for those who are suffering. We need selfless people like Mia and to help folks in developing countries who struggle to meet even their most basic needs. We need artists like Rebecca and Megan, dancers like Flannery and Kendra, musicians like Jack to provide enjoyment, inspiration, and culture. We need Haley, Sydney, and Griffin to educate our kids about more than just math and reading. And we need Pauline to show us the real way to be kind and live without judging others. And especially, we need all of us who have or will have kids, to be good parents and teach our children how to be good people. The point is that everybody has a role when it comes to making the world a better place, and no one profession or calling is any better or more important than another. No matter what each of us end up doing, each and every one of us has the potential to be a part of the solution. What matters isn't what you do with your life, it's how you do it. And I truly believe that every graduate in the class of 2015 is a good person. Many of us have been through some very difficult situations and experiences. Several of us have lost parents or loved ones, including myself, but that hasn't made us bitter. We've persevered, and that is a testament to our supportive and loving community, Island Strong. We are going to need all of that strength to deal with the big, tough problems we're up against. To fix global problems, everybody has to change to some degree, and none of us have the exact right solutions. It's critical that we're all willing to listen to others, and I mean really listen, not just shut up until it's our turn to talk again. This takes an enormous amount of cooperation. You might wonder, how do we even start? Well, the first and best steps on the way to cooperation are tolerance, kindness, and gratitude. We can't have people looking down on others because of their jobs, or color, or religion, or who they choose to love. We can't judge people to be any less than us based on any part of them because they're all just as important. Everyone has the right to feel valued, and we need to recognize the importance in everyone. Solutions require teamwork, and every member of the team is crucial to its success. What we need is people to be genuinely kind to others. When you accept and share kindness with everyone, you make vital connections. We also need to be aware of how lucky we are in so many ways and acknowledge the many people who have helped and will help us to continue as we continue to grow up. I've had many people who've helped me grow and mature and have been the best role models I could have asked for. To all of you, I'm extremely grateful. Above all else, we need to be positive. There are a whole lot of really serious problems with the adult world that we're about to enter that seem impossible to fix. They are impossible for one person to fix, but they are solvable if a whole lot of people get involved. At this time, the world needs positivity. And optimism might seem naive, but who's ever gotten anything done by saying it couldn't be done? Nobody. We need doers and thinkers and everybody in between to believe that they can make a difference, however big or small, by being kind, being cooperative, being tolerant, being grateful, and staying positive. Class of 2015, we got this. Thank you.
And with that, it's time to move on to the presentation of the diplomas. As we present the diplomas, I'd like to welcome the families of the graduates. If they'd like to come up and take pictures in this area, feel free to do that. Also, before we proceed, I'd like to make sure everybody's aware, after the presentation of the diplomas and the recessional, there will be a reception in the cafeteria for graduates and their friends and family. I'd like to invite Charles Ray, the chairman of the school board, up to read the names of the graduating seniors.
Stand up and come over here. Thanks.
How do you want to know? You said it's going to be good. Because they're going to hand you the diplomas.
Excuse me, Pauline Garcia. Mary Van Ran. Sitara Malayu. Caitlin May Burns. Madison Brown. Tia Menzetti. Jasmine Bender. Rose Besson McNowell. Kirsten Roundsville. Flannery Rose Dillon. Joni Mangarella. Genevieve Mayren Renee Goble. Christopher Smith. Patrick Falkingham. Andrew Hanscom. Jacob Wenger. Brandon Lamar Murphy. Will Smith. Tyler Philbrook. Chase Allen McKee. Jordan Winter Harris. Isaac Krasnow. Griffin Graves. Ethan Crago. Maeve Geary. Jane Harley. Robin Nicholson. Elsa Bannerman. Stephanie Marie Perkins. Irie Rose Heyman. Samantha Nicole Sawyer. Hannah Perry. Caroline Driscoll. Abigail Irvine. Sakura Sunagawa. Kayla Ray. Aiden Cyril Robichaud Ward. Sandy Wolf Hengeler. Jordy Hodgson. Jonathan Romero. John Weaver. William Orion Green. Cordell Soper. Hamish Sven Stevenson. Connor Crandall. Ralph Magnani. Henry Stanley Helmke. Brandon Davis. Lexi Young. Emily Koff. Anna Busker. Megan Frost. Emma Fernal. Molly E. Carroll. Haley C. Littlefield. Kendra Bonzi. Tuva Vick. Claire Elk. Michaela Murray. Angel Warren. John Joseph Sastner. Thomas Carl Paola. Aaron Winfield Adam Miller. Wilder Alden Young. Matthew Hanna. John Bowmill. Simon Henry Holbert. Hunter Strash. Bailey Moore. Matthew Wolfolk. Caleb Graham. Nicholas Krebs. Goodwin. Trisha Smith. Taylor Bowden. Lauren Eaton. Sarah Norberg. Megan McDonough. Ivy E. Wallace. Mia K. Strout. Camilla Thomason Ty. Thank you. calling. Mackenzie Lynn Myers. Hannah J. Carroll. Luke Horton. Gabriel Candish. Clifton Jeffrey. Nathan Vonderhaar. David Joseph Anderson. McLean Isaacs. Alex Dimitriev. James O'Donnell. Stephanie Crossman. Ashley McEachran. Gabrielle Giuliano. Anita Elliott Ray. Waylon Lynn Francis Engler. Elise Robertson. Delaney Colson. Summit Amber Garland. Carly Henderson. Amy Crossman. Chelsea Thomas. Sarah Phelps. Alexandra Bierman. Clara Johnson. Greta Smaller. Helena Van Meteren Munson. Sydney Wright. Layla Johnston. Thank you. MDI community members, please congratulate the graduating class of 2015.